Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Worship at Mount Lebanon Evangelical Presbyterian Church on this Easter Sunday, Resurrection Day, and how blessed we are to have seen the faces of some of our church members with the greeting for Easter Sunday, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. We had our youngest member and one of our senior members to welcome us this day with that greeting. Let us now take time to open this worship time with prayer. Will you join me? Eternal God, we are grateful for this Easter Sunday. Lord, we come to you with hearts open and ready to hear the message that you have for us this day. Lord, thank you for opening the grave. The stone was rolled away, and Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Lord, we come to you, giving you all of the glory and the honor and the praise this day. And we pray these things in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Lord, Lord. What an amazing gift it is to gather together on Easter Sunday and lay our sins at the foot of the cross. Please join me for our prayer of confession, followed by a moment of silent confession. Gracious Father, you sent your Son to die and rise to new life, in order that death might be brought to an end and that we might live a new life in him. Yet we confess that we too often have chosen to remain captive to doubt and fear and the ways that lead to death. By our thoughts, words, and actions, we have scorned your love, diminished the lives of others, and defaced your image in us. Father, forgive us for Jesus' sake. Enable us by his resurrection power to live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us. Amen. Brothers and sisters, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. On that first Easter morning, he rose again from the grave and conquered sin and death. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
Our scripture reading for today is from Isaiah 25, verses 7 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord will destroy the shroud that enfolds all people. The veil that covers all nations, he will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him, and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trust in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation.
Thanks, Ashley. Our gospel reading for today comes from the Gospel of Luke. We have the scene where the disciples who have experienced Jesus on the road to Emmaus have come back with exciting news. This is Luke 24, starting with verse 36. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they had seen a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bone like you see that I have." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet, and while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Holy God, we ask that you would open our minds to understand, even as Jesus did on that first Easter morning, as the disciples were scared and not knowing what was going to happen, you came in and you said, "Peace be with you." Lord, we ask for your peace. We ask for your power. We ask for the wonder, joy, and amazement of that first Easter morning, as we seek to follow you, learn from you, and show your glory to the world. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Behind locked doors, in isolation, covered with fear and doubt. That sounds really familiar right now, doesn't it? It is amazing how similar, in some ways, our situation right now, Easter 2020, is to that very first Easter. The disciples were huddled together in fear. They isolated themselves from everyone around them. All of this was debilitating to them. They were in complete isolation. They didn't know what was going to happen. They were afraid that what would happen to Jesus, what had happened to Jesus, would happen to them. And into that moment, into that locked room, Jesus appeared. And he stood among them and he said, "Peace be with you." Wouldn't it be amazing to have Jesus standing among us right now in the middle of your living room, in the middle of wherever you're sitting? Jesus Christ coming and saying, "Peace be with you." As we look through this passage today and consider the Easter story on that first Easter morning, we see Jesus Christ appearing from the dead, breaking through all of the things that the disciples understood and thought they understood. He's breaking through all of that, and he's giving them gifts they didn't know that they needed. He is giving them peace. He's giving them understanding. He's giving them freedom from all of the locked doors and isolation, and he is sending them out to a new ministry that they never dreamed about. But think about what the disciples had gone through. Think about what they had experienced up to this point. You can understand why they would be so afraid. These men and women had been with Jesus for 3 years or some of them longer than that. They had walked with him and learned from him and seen the incredible miracles he'd done. They had been on the boat when Jesus calmed the storm. They had handed out the bread that ended up feeding 5,000 people. Why are they now in a locked room doubting so much? They've had the most incredible week any of us can even imagine. It feels like our whole world has been turned upside down in the last month, but their whole world was turned upside down in 4 days. Think about that first night, on Maundy Thursday, as Jesus Christ broke bread, as they shared the Passover together, and he said, this is my body broken for you. And as he shared it, and as he poured out the cup, and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant of my blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. The disciples must have been dumbstruck. What in the world is he talking about? Why is he saying this? What does he mean? He is going to be broken and poured out for us. But even in that moment, even at that meal, he told them that not just one, but two of them would betray him. Judas had already gone to the Sanhedrin. He had gotten 30 pieces of silver to turn Jesus over to the authorities. Peter, of course, said, well, I would never do that. And Jesus looked straight at him and said, Peter, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter was heartbroken that Jesus said that he would do that. Of course, he would never do that. And sure enough, just a few hours later, Peter told a slave girl, why would you be afraid of a slave girl? But Peter told a slave girl who asked, aren't you one of those guys from Galilee? And he said, I don't know what you're talking about. And the rooster crowed, and Peter instantly knew that what Christ had known about him and known was in his heart came true, and he went away and wept bitterly. Things only went downhill from there as Jesus was arrested by the authorities at Judas's prompting, as he was brought before an illegal trial, as he was, they played political ping pong and passed the buck as Pilate sent him to Herod, and Herod sent him back to Pilate, and Pilate sent him in front of the crowd, and the crowd said, crucify him. Crucify him. Crucifixion was the most horrendous form of death any of us can imagine. It wasn't just execution, it was torture. They nailed his hands and his feet to the cross. They hung him up so that he couldn't even breathe. To be able to breathe, he had to lift himself up by his hands. Finally, the sky went dark. It was black for 3 hours. And at the end, he finally said, it is finished. It is finished. Not that he was finished, but that his work was finished. The battle he fought was finished, and he had conquered. But still the disciples didn't understand that. Still they didn't understand what was happening. An earthquake hit, and even the veil of the temple was torn in two in the moment that he breathed his last. It was like God the Father rending his own garments at the death of his son. Then, as they saw Jesus was truly dead, Joseph of Arimathea came and asked for his body and took it down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. They rolled a massive stone in front of the tomb, and the Romans posted a guard in front of the tomb because they didn't want anybody coming and messing with it or stealing his body. They had heard the rumors that he would rise again on the third day. They didn't want any suspicion of that happening. And then they went home. The women, the men who had been with him, they all went home into their locked doors in isolation. All of Saturday, the Sabbath, they were completely powerless to do anything about their situation. And Jesus, the one in whom they had put all of their hope, Jesus was dead, lying in a tomb. Can you imagine that Saturday, that incredibly long day, isolated and alone, and not knowing what had happened, what would happen? Would the same thing that had happened to Jesus happen to them? It was the women that first Easter morning, the women that got up early before the sun even rose so that they could go to the tomb, so that they could anoint his body appropriately for burial. They didn't even think about what they would do when they got there, this massive, probably 2-ton stone rolled in front of the tomb. How are we going to move that away? They couldn't even think about that. They just knew that they had to get there. But when they got to the tomb, that massive stone, it looked like a giant had just picked it up and tossed it aside. The ropes that had been binding it, the wax seals, they'd all been just blown apart. And they looked in the tomb, and where his body had laid, there was no body. The grave clothes were just empty. The headscarf was folded up. And when they looked, they saw an angel who said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He's risen." The women could hardly believe it. They didn't even know what to think. They ran back to tell the disciples, but the disciples didn't believe them. The disciples thought they were crazy. The women's testimony didn't even hold up in a court of law, so that why should they believe these crazy women? It's not possible. They saw him die themselves. They didn't believe the women. They didn't believe the angels. And then earlier in Luke 24, two disciples are walking despairingly toward Emmaus. They have their hearts in their hands. They don't know what to think. They are in complete despair and confusion. And a stranger comes up beside them and says, Why are you so downcast?" They explain to them, him, "Didn't you hear about Jesus of Nazareth and what happened? And then our women came up with this crazy story, and that certainly doesn't make sense." And the stranger starts to open the scriptures to them and tell them one thing after another about why the Messiah had to come, why he had to suffer and die, like it describes in Isaiah 53, and how God had promised that he would rise again from the dead. They still didn't understand. They got to their house. They invited the stranger in to come and eat with them, and Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body." And suddenly their eyes were opened. And in the instant their eyes were opened, Jesus then disappeared. They didn't even know what to think. They said, "Weren't our hearts burning within us as he explained the scriptures?" So they ran back. They ran back to Jerusalem the whole way. And they came and they were telling the disciples, "You're not going to believe what just happened." And the disciples still didn't believe what just happened. They couldn't believe the women. They couldn't believe the reports of the angels. Peter had even had a sighting, and they didn't believe him. Now these men from Emmaus showed up, and they were just dumbstruck by that. So here they are, still behind locked doors, still isolated, still scared. And Jesus himself appears. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Here they were. It says they were startled and frightened, thinking he was a ghost. How many more times does the Lord have to prove to them that he's real? And yet they were startled and frightened again because it didn't make sense. It didn't make any human sense at all. They saw him die. And here he was standing right in front of them. He asked them, "Why are you troubled? Why do you doubt? Do you not understand?" And he showed them his hands and his feet. He showed them and said, "See, touch, it's okay." The scars that Jesus bore from the crucifixion were still with him. This wasn't a ghost that was able to erase all the bad things that had happened. This was the living Lord Jesus Christ who was permanently marked with the sacrifice of his crucifixion. As he said this, he looked at them, and they still struggled to believe. It says they still did not believe because of joy and amazement. In the King James, I love this version. It says they still did not believe for joy and marveled. It was too good to be true. How in the world could this be true? We must be dreaming. We must be making it up. This can't be real. And Jesus finally said, "Okay, I'll eat something." And so they handed him a piece of fish. And he ate, and they began to see that, wait a minute, this can't just be something we make up in our heads. Only Jesus would have said, "Okay, let me prove it to you. Hand me some fish."
But Jesus was able to break through all of their doubt. Even as he had walked through those locked doors, he was able to break through their fear. And slowly, slowly they began to understand the peace that he was offering to them. It's funny that Jesus had told them many times that he was going to have to die. He had told them that he would rise again on the third day, but they didn't understand it. In Luke 18, it says, Jesus took the 12 aside and told them, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that was written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be handed over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, insult him, spit on him, flog him, and kill him. On the third day, he will rise again." But the disciples did not understand any of this. Its meaning was hidden from them, and they did not know what he was talking about. Jesus had warned them, he had explained it to them, but their minds were too closed. They couldn't understand what he was talking about. Jesus walks in, and he gives them the gift of peace. He walks in, and suddenly they realize that they don't need to be afraid anymore. As he says, "My peace I give to you. My peace I leave you with you." We think of that, about that passage from Philippians 4 that says, "The peace that passes understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." That is the peace that Jesus brings when he walks into this room. That room will never, ever be the same again. Jesus, as he offers them his peace, as that fear begins to subside, then he gives them a second gift. He says to them, it says in verse 45, "Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures." Their minds had been closed before when he told them in chapter 18 and many other times. Their minds had been closed. They weren't able to understand or even begin to comprehend what was going on and how all of this tied together. But now Jesus opens their minds. They finally are able to see. He grants them the gift of understanding. So many of us struggle with doubts. Fear is almost part and parcel with doubt. As fear consumes us, doubt also undermines everything that we think that we understand and know. You can see the disciples trying to rely on human reason during this. It has to be a ghost because he can't be here. He can't have risen from the dead because we saw him die. And yet, Jesus Christ is very real, and he is able to blow through their human understanding and open their minds so that they understand Scripture. Not just Scripture, a few little pieces, but the thread of all of Scripture. How from the very beginning, from Genesis 1, all the way through the stories about David, Moses, Abraham, all of these stories, the arc of that is all tied together. And Jesus shows them in understanding, the gift of understanding, how it all comes together. Jesus gives them the gift of peace. He gives them the gift of understanding. And then he tells them, "You are witnesses." He tells them, as he explains all this stuff, "You are witnesses of all of these things, and I am going to send you what my Father has promised." He means the Holy Spirit there. "I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. Stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Jesus Christ breaks through their locked doors. He calms their troubled, terrified minds. And then he sets them free with a new calling on their lives. He bursts through those doors and he sends them out. We see later in the passage as Jesus is taken up into heaven that they return with great joy and they spend all of their time not behind locked doors anymore. They spend their whole time in the temple praising God. Their cries, their heartache, their despair has been transformed into language of prayer and praise. They stand in the temple courts in public, ready to be taken any time But God is able to protect them and fill them with power through the Holy Spirit so that their voices proclaim. And we see in Acts 2, thousands of people come to know that Jesus Christ is the Lord, is the risen Lord and Savior. He is the one who has died for our forgiveness, for the forgiveness of sins. As we think about this new freedom that he has granted his people, as he has set them free to go into their calling, it's an incredible time to think about what it means for us as we also are trapped behind locked doors, afraid, worried about what the future is going to hold, not knowing who we are in the midst of this strange time where it seems like all of the rules, all the measuring sticks, all of everything is different. All of our routines that felt safe and secure have changed. All of the things that we gained our identity from are gone. I've talked to several of you who feel like you're crippled with fear right now. So many people around this world are crippled with fear. You're behind locked doors, and you don't know what in the world is going to happen next. You don't know which newscast to trust. You don't know what in the world the future is going to hold. For those of you who are crippled with fear, Jesus Christ offers you his peace. He is able, in his amazing, incredible, divine way, to stand in the middle of the room where you are right now and say, "My peace be with you." The peace that passes understanding. Fear is one of those, it's actually a tool of Satan. Satan loves to use fear because he's able to lock people in when he uses fear. When he keeps reminding you of all the things that are going to go wrong and all of the ways that you will be shamed in front of people, all of the different things that will be more painful than you can even imagine. Satan loves to use that to trap you. But instead of that fear is from Satan, but peace is from God. The scripture says perfect love casts out all fear. Jesus Christ's perfect love, the perfect love of one man who sacrificed himself for all of our sins. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That kind of love that still bears scars in his hands and his feet, that is the perfect love that casts out all fear. Yes, we have a very unknown future. We don't know what it's going to be like here in a week, much less a month or a year. But we have Christ who is with us, and his peace makes infinitely more sense than any human understanding. His peace is what comes in and is able to take over our hearts, to drive away the enemy's lies, and to set us free from that bondage that we're in. I think some of us are afraid of external things. Others of us are afraid of internal things like shame, guilt, remorse, hurt, unforgiveness. That traps us. All of those things trap us inside, whether it's inside our homes or inside our hearts. Wherever you feel trapped, wherever the enemy is using fear to hold you in, cry out to the Lord. Ask him to come in. Ask him to stand there. Ask him to come through those locked doors and proclaim peace to you. May God give you that peace. Many of you feel trapped by doubt, feel trapped by confusion, that it just doesn't make human sense. How can I trust in this guy that lived 2,000 years ago and had some neat things to teach, but then they said he rose from the dead? Think about it. These were the people that were with him for 3 years. They heard every word that he taught, and still they were overcome with doubt. They didn't believe it was possible. And Jesus showed up and stood right there with them and held out his hands and his feet. And even then they couldn't believe. He ate something, and still they struggled to believe. But Jesus Christ opened their minds. He gave them the gift of faith. And suddenly, the gift of faith opened up a brand new understanding of all of it, how all of the pieces fit together. If you feel crippled by doubt right now, ask the Lord to come in through those locked doors of your mind, to open those doors wide, to show you what it means that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. My father was a doubter. He grew up going to church but didn't believe in Jesus. Finally, when he was in his late 20s, he had heard again the gospel from a friend, and he went home and he was thinking about it and wrestling with it, and he just couldn't believe. And he was listening to one of the arias from Handel's Messiah, "I know that my Redeemer lives." And he prayed to the Lord, "Lord, I do not believe that Jesus is your son. If you want me to believe, you're going to have to do that for me because I can't do it myself." He asked for the Lord to change his mind, to change his understanding. He says, when he first started listening to that song, "I know that my Redeemer liveth, and he will stand on this earth in the last day." When he started listening to that song, he didn't believe. And when that song was over, he believed. And he believed for the rest of his life. God opened his mind. He gave him the gift of faith and understanding so that he could see how Christ worked through all of it and loved him that much. Many of us are crippled by unknowns, by wondering what is going to happen, how we can escape all of these things. I told you last week that Corrie ten Boom, a woman who survived the Holocaust, has a famous quote, "Do not be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God." As I pray that God lifts fear from your life, that he unlocks the doors of your mind and your heart, I pray that he will let you know him. That you will know who he is, that you will know how much he loves you, that he loved you so much, that he didn't only just come to earth, but he suffered and he died. And he rose again from the dead, and that is our proof that all of this is true. Think about the incredible change in the disciples. They went from hiding in a locked room. Do you think those people hiding in a locked room, afraid, could change the world if they hadn't seen Jesus? If Jesus rising from the dead was just a metaphor, they would have stayed in that locked room. They would have stayed huddled up together, afraid of how they might get hurt. The biggest evidence of Jesus rising from the dead is the disciples rising from the dead. They were dead in their fear. They were dead in their misunderstanding. They were dead in this huddled place. And Jesus Christ showed up and he showed them that he was alive. He opened their minds. He opened their hearts and he sent them out. And think how they changed the world after that. Think how they changed not only Jerusalem, but all of Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. People all across this globe have seen that Jesus Christ is Lord because those 12 people had their doors flown open because of Jesus Christ. Are you locked in right now? It sure feels like our whole country is locked in right now. But we do not need to be afraid. We do not need to be oppressed by this thing that is going on. We don't even need to fear death. Paul says to live is Christ, to die is gain. We can rest in this known Savior, this known God who loved us so much he died for us and appeared to his disciples, to the women, to 500 other people before he ascended into heaven. And he is present with us even right now. We do not need to be crippled by any of these things anymore because Jesus Christ is risen from the grave. Brothers and sisters, go and be witnesses of this good news around the world. Amen. Let's pray together. Holy God, we do thank you and we praise you for your power, your gift, your ability to break open locked doors to set us free. Lord, you know ways that we are locked in that we can't even see ourselves. Lord, we pray that you would open our hearts that you would destroy the lies of fear that Satan is trying to use to keep us in bondage. Lord, we pray that you would break open the locks of shame, that we would no longer be afraid of what other people might think about us and all the ways that we've failed. Lord, we pray that you would break open the locks on our minds that block us from understanding who you are and what you've done. Lord, and we pray that you would blast open the doors that are holding us back from being your witnesses. Send us out, Lord. Send us out with power from the Holy Spirit. Send us out with love and with confidence and with a sense that we will never be alone again. We will never be abandoned. We will never be forsaken, for you are with us. Lord, I pray for those who are watching right now that have never talked to you before. Lord, I pray that you would open their hearts right even right now. If that is one of you, would you pray with me right now? Lord God, it is so hard to understand in our humanness, in our human nature. Fear has been overcoming us. But Lord, we lay that down before you. We pray that you would break through these closed doors, locked doors in our minds, in our hearts, in our lives. Lord, we submit to you and we trust you. Please, Lord, give us the gift of peace. Give us the gift of faith. Give us the gift of understanding. Transform our lives too, so that we will no longer be trapped by fear, but set free in joy. And now, all brothers and sisters, please join me as we pray, as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come arise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come and rise up from the grave.
stretched out on the tree. He took the nails for me.
Brothers and sisters, it has been wonderful to worship with you today. We pray that you have been blessed by the music, by the children, by the whole church family as we have come together to worship. You are not alone, even as you feel isolated, but our Holy Father is with us. Jesus Christ is present even in this moment with every one of us. As I've told you before, we can't pass an offering plate, but you can always give online if you would like to, mlepc.org, and hit the donate button. You can also mail a check to the church anytime that you would like to. And if you would like prayer, we would love to pray with you anytime. You can call our church office, or you can send an email to info@mlepc.org, and we can call you back and would love to pray with you. If you have any needs, please let us know. And now, brothers and sisters, it is incredible to think of all that God has given us. He has given us peace. He has given us understanding. He has given us freedom and calling. But it's not our strength that will enable us to do this. It is the Holy Spirit power that is able to work in us and through us to change the world like God did with the disciples. And it is to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to the Holy Spirit power that is already at work within you. To him be glory in you, the church, and through Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.
I was there.